Good afternoon. Welcome to Indian Polity class. So today we will discuss about the governor. When we have discussed about the president of India, we said that he is a nominal executive and he has so many functions, rather powers, and all the functions of the union government are exercised in the name of the president. Similarly, for each state, you have a governor. And the governor is also considered to be the nominal executive at the state level. At the same time, even at the state level, every order, every function is exercised under the name of the governor. That's the reason with respect to the powers and functions, there are so many similarities between the office of the president and the office of the governor. There is no much difference at all. Hence, most of the points what we have discussed during the president will be repeated even in this particular topic. So we can complete this topic early because we have discussed the office of the president in a very, very detailed manner. Now, so office of the governor is considered to be the most important office at the state level. He is considered to be the first citizen of the state. The original constitution said that there shall be a governor for each state. Meaning, if I have a state, there should be a governor. But over a period of time, in the year 1956, the constitution was amended, and that was the 7th amendment. And one of the changes that were brought in through the 7th amendment was that single person can be appointed as a governor for more than one state. It happens very frequently in India. All of a sudden, a governor may submit the resignation letter. A governor may die. During that time, the central government takes some time to appoint somebody as the governor for that state. Till that time, the neighboring state governor or some other governor will be also appointed as a governor for the other state. Meaning additional charges will be given to the existing governor. During that time, he will act as the governor for two states. So live example, as of today, we have two states. One is Andhra Pradesh, second one is Telangana state. For these two states put together, we have only one person. We have only one person as the governor. Meaning same person is acting as the governor for Telangana and same gentleman is also working as the governor for Andhra Pradesh. But what about the salary? The salary of the governor is decided by the parliament. The present salary of the governor is 1,10,000 rupees. But whenever a single person is acting as the governor for two or more states, the salary is divided among the states. Salary, the maximum salary is that 1,10,000 rupees. Instead of getting the salary from one state, he'll be getting the salary from two different states. The salary will be divided proportionately. And the rest of the points are again simple. With respect to the qualifications of the governor, just two things. One is he should be a citizen of India. And number two, he should have completed 35 years of age. Anybody with these qualifications can be appointed as the governor. The appointment is made by the President of India, and the President of India acts on the behest of the Council of Ministers headed by the Prime Minister. Meaning in reality, it is the Prime Minister who decides who should be the governor of a state. Accordingly, the President will appoint a person as the governor. When it comes to the oath of office, kindly compare. The president's oath of office is administered by Chief Justice of India. When it comes to the governor, For governor, oath of office is administered by Chief Justice of the concerned High Court. At any time, the governor may submit the resignation letter, and the resignation letter is submitted to the president. At any time, the governor may be removed. No reasons, nothing. Reasons are not mentioned in the constitution. The governor holds the office during the pleasure of the president. At any time, he may be removed from the office. And the removal is done by the president of India, again, and the advice of the prime minister. And once a person has been appointed as a governor, the president may transfer the person from one state to the other state. Normally, whenever you are appointing a person, he will be appointed as a governor for a period of 5 years. But it does not mean that he will be holding the office for complete 5 years. Meaning, at any time he can be removed. Meaning, the concept of the pleasure of the president is playing the crucial role. In between these 5 years, he may be transferred from one state to the other state. Or once 5 years are over, his term may be extended, or he may be reappointed as the governor. Anything may happen with respect to the office of the governor. Ultimately, what I would like to say is that there is no security of tenure to the office of the governor. We have seen so many cases in the recent past. For example, Sheila Dikshit. She was the chief minister of Delhi for 3 terms. Later, after the elections of 2013, after a very, very serious debacle of the Congress party, Manmohan Singh government appointed Sheila Dikshit as the governor for Kerala. But within a very short period of time, so there was a change of guard at the central level. Instead of UPA government, NDA government came to the power. And immediately after that one, Sheila Dikshit was asked to submit the resignation letter. Meaning there is no security. The previous prime minister recommended the president of India to appoint somebody as the governor. Later, the new prime minister has sent the message for the resignation. Accordingly, the person has submitted the resignation letters. So this is the basic idea with respect to the office of the governor. Apart from this, the governor has almost similar functions like that of the president, like legislative powers, executive powers, judicial powers, financial powers, and so on. So we'll try to see very fastly all these things. But kindly remember, most of the points are just similar to that of the president. Look at this. So we are talking about the governor. The first point is that the state executive is mentioned in part 6 of the Indian Constitution. This part 6 talks about the, look at the highlighted portion. It talks about the governor, chief minister, council of ministers, state legislature, and the advocate general at the state levels. We have seen attorney general at the central level. Similarly, I have another office called advocate general, and that office is present at the state level. President is for the union, Indian Union. Governor is for the state. Prime Minister for India, Chief Minister for a state. And the words Council of Ministers is common. The same terminology we are using at the central level and also at the state levels. Followed by the state legislature and the so-called the Advocate General. So here I am using the word state legislatures. At the central level, I use the word central legislature or the so-called the parliament. And when it comes to central level for entire India, I have attorney general. At the state level, I have the advocate general. But all the offices are just similar with respect to the function. Look at this. Articles 153 to 167 in part 6 of the Indian Constitution deal with the state executive. Look at this. I've given something in the form of the note. Let's see what is this. Part 6 of the Indian Constitution is not applicable to the state of Jammu and Kashmir as it enjoys a special status and it also has a separate constitution. See, let me tell you one point. Within the description of the constitution itself in part 6, before we start reading the part 6 of Indian Constitution, the constitution mentions very clearly that in part 6, until and unless specifically it is mentioned as Jammu and Kashmir, Jammu and Kashmir is not included in the state. Very important. Because since beginning, Jammu and Kashmir has been given a separate status. Hence, Jammu and Kashmir is not part of part 6 of the Indian Constitution. It has not been given any place in part 6 of Indian Constitution. But otherwise, with respect to the Jammu and Kashmir, Article 370 speaks. Hence, when we come to Article number 370, when we speak elaborately regarding the state of Jammu and Kashmir. Hence, in this particular chapter, part 6 of Indian Constitution, whatever we say, we have nothing to do with the Jammu and Kashmir, but we are talking about the rest of the states in the country, excluding Jammu and Kashmir. Am I clear? Now, let me open the document and show it to you once again. Look at this. The office of the governor at the state level is similar to that of the president at the central level. The governor is the constitutional head. Just like the president of India, the governor of the state is a de jure. We know the meaning of all these things we have discussed. When it comes to the appointment, the governor of a state is appointed by the president of India by warrant under his hand and seal. Note, in United States of America, the governor of a state is elected directly by the people. Just remember this. In United States of America also, there are so many states. Even in India also, there are so many states. But they exercise a concept of complete federation. But whereas in India, it is a quasi federal in nature. Hence, states in India are not as independent as the states in United States of America. Whereas in USA, because it is a complete federation, each state has got its own constitution. But whereas in India, states are not permitted to have any constitution. There is only one constitution, that is called the Constitution of India, and that constitution also gives the powers to the state governments and state legislatures. Am I clear? Now, let's go ahead. Let me open the document. Look at this. When it comes to the oath of office of the governor, it is administered by the Chief Justice of the concerned High Court. Appointment by the President. Oath of office is administered by the Chief Justice. And because of any reason, if the Chief Justice of the concerned High Court is not available, no problem, then the senior most judge of the concerned High Court administers the oath of office. Meaning is simple. Without being administered oath of office, a person cannot start performing his responsibilities as the governor. Hence, it should be administered by the Chief Justice of the concerned High Court or, in his absence, any other senior most judge of the same High Court. Next, when it comes to the qualifications, we have seen already, should be a citizen of India, we understood. he should have completed 35 years of age, not equal to 35, but he should have completed the age of 35 years. Next one. When it comes to the conditions, what do you mean by these conditions? First of all, here, let's see these conditions. Look at this highlighted portion. He should not be a member of either of the houses of the parliament, or he should not be a member of either of the houses of the state legislatures. But if any such person is appointed as the governor, he is deemed to have vacated his seat in that house on the date on which he enters upon his office of governor. Meaning, at the time of appointment, he should not be a member of either central legislature or the state legislature. But if any such person is appointed as the governor, then it is considered to be his previous position is automatically vacated. Example, a member of parliament is appointed as the governor. The moment he takes oath of office, his membership in the parliament is automatically gone. That is the meaning of this. At the same time, he should not hold any office of profit. Clear? I have given something in the form of your note. In Har Gobind versus Raghukul case, the Supreme Court held that the office of the governor was not an office of profit under the government. So meaning, in one of the judgments, it made it very, very clear. That's the reason why a person, while he is holding the office of the governor, can be reappointed as the governor. Okay, look at this. The governor is entitled without the payment of rent to use the Raj Bhavan. President's residence is called Rashtrapati Bhavan, and governor's official residence is called Raj Bhavan. Right? Next. I'll go to this next one, salary here. If you look at the salary, privileges and allowances, everything will be decided by the parliament. Next, the emoluments and allowances of the governor cannot be diminished during the term of office. We already know this point. Whatever may be the office under the Constitution of India, every office, the privileges and the salary, nothing should be varied to their disadvantage. That should not be diminished. It cannot be lowered. If you want to increase, yes, very much permitted. Diminishing, not permitted. Next point. I'll open the document here. And I told you this point already. So this gentleman, the governor, is now getting a salary of 1,10,000 rupees per month. Similarly, when it comes to this immunity, we have already seen the president has immunity. In the similar manner, the governor also has a great immunity. Look at the point here, the first point. The governor is immune from any criminal proceedings, even in respect of his personal acts. It is not just in the official acts, even in the personal acts also. If he commits any crime, then he is immune. He cannot be arrested. Look at the point number two. The governor cannot be arrested or imprisoned. Next one is the civil proceedings can be instituted against the governor after giving 2 months' notice in respect of his personal acts. Very important here. With respect to the civil proceedings, 2 months advance notice should be given to him, then only he can be asked to appear before the court. But with respect to the criminal cases, he cannot be arrested under any circumstances. That is the meaning of this. Next, we have already seen certain points here. The term of office, that is nothing but The governor holds the office during the pleasure of the president. Very, very important, I told you. But whenever he is being appointed, the constitution says very clearly that the governor is appointed for a period of 5 years. But the 5 years is not guaranteed. At any time, the president may remove the governor from the office. That's the reason. If there is a clash between the 5 years and the pleasure of the president of India, then the pleasure of the president will dominate and the person will be removed from the office. Okay. Now, look at this next one. Removal. The governor may be removed by the president at any time. And the constitution does not lay down any ground upon which a governor may be removed by the president. No rules, no regulations, at any time he may be removed. In the sense, the governor has no security of tenure, but the governor has, but at the same time, governor also has no fixed term of office. Very important, no fixed term of office. When I use the word no fixed term of office, if everything is fine, he will continue for a period of 5 years. But otherwise, at any time, he can be removed. In the similar manner, simple point, resignation. The governor can resign at any time by addressing a resignation letter to the president. Next one is a transfer. When it comes to the transfer, the president may transfer a governor from one state to the other state. Simple. Appointed by the president of India. Removed by the president of India. Transfer by the president of India. Reappointment by the president of India. Meaning everywhere the president is coming into the picture, but kindly remember the president is acting on the advice that is provided by the prime minister. In the similar manner, reappointment. Reappointment in the sense, appointing the governor as the governor again is called a reappointment. Very much permitted. Read the statement. The president may reappoint a person as the governor for the same state or some other state. Next, if you look at the functions here, the functions are just similar to the president of India. Hence, the governor has executive functions. I am highlighting on the screen, legislative functions, judicial functions, financial functions. But look at the last statement. Governor does not have diplomatic functions. Diplomatic functions in the sense these powers are related to dealing with the people of other nations. Sending our ambassadors to some other countries, receiving the ambassadors of other countries, dealing with international institutions, they are exclusively for the president of India and the governor has nothing to do with that. Hence, governor does not enjoy any diplomatic powers. Similarly, military powers and emergency powers. We have already seen when it comes to the military, that military will be under the control of the president of India, meaning under the control of the central government. That is the reason why Army, Air Force, Navy, so they will be working under the directions of the president of India and the central government. And protecting the state is the responsibility of the central government. That's the reason governor does not have any military powers. In the similar manner, emergency powers. During the emergency situations, it is the responsibility of the central government to provide security to the state. That is being done by the president of India. That's the reason why there is no point in giving such type of powers to the governor. Hence, kindly remember, though he is compared to the office of the president, but certain functions like diplomatic functions, emergency powers, and also the military powers are not exercised by the governor at the state level. This is one difference between the president and the governor. And we will see some more differences are there during our course of discussion. We'll try to understand. Next one. If you look at this executive powers, you know what is the meaning of this. The governor will be appointing so many people here. The governor of a state appoints the chief minister and other ministers. The governor appoints the advocate general of the state and determines the remuneration. Meaning is simple. Attorney general by the president of India. Advocate general by the governor. Prime minister by the president. Chief minister by the governor. Similarly, the governor appoints the state election commissioner. He also appoints the chairman and members of the state public service commission. Next one, the governor has every right to seek any information relating to the administration of the affairs of the state and proposals for the legislation from the chief minister. This particular power we have already seen from the office of the president. President can seek the information from the prime minister. Similarly, governor can seek the information from the chief minister. Similarly, the governor can require the chief minister to submit for the reconsideration of the council of ministers any matter on which a decision has been taken by a minister but which has not been considered by the council. Sometimes the chief minister and a single minister may take a decision. And for the executing that decision, the signature of the governor is a must. But if the governor comes to know that the decision has been taken only by the chief minister and the concerned minister, then the governor may ask the chief minister to submit the particular proposal for reconsideration of the council of ministers. Similarly, the governor can recommend for the president's rule. During the emergency powers, we have understood what exactly is this. During the president's rule, the governor enjoys the extensive executive powers. Similarly, the governor appoints the vice chancellors of various universities in the state, and he himself acts as the chancellor of the universities in the state. Kindly remember, the vice chancellors of the universities at the state level are appointed by the governor, and the governor is performing this function in the capacity as the chancellor of universities. Am I clear? Next one is let's see the legislative powers of the governors. Simple. Again, on day one itself, we have understood that we have a concept of legislature. In India, I have two categories of legislatures. One is the union legislature, otherwise called parliament. Second one is the state legislature. When I speak about the union legislature, I speak in terms of the Lok Sabha, Rajya Sabha, and the president. During that time, I made it very clear. The president is a part of the parliament. President is not a member of the parliament, but he is a part of the parliament. Because he is a part of the parliament, he exercises so many functions towards the parliament. And what are those functions? We have understood very clearly during that time while I was talking to you regarding the president. In the similar manner, at the state legislature, either it may be unicameral or it may be bicameral. If I use the word unicameral, in that state legislature, there is only assembly. Assembly is there and the governors. If I have assembly and governor, that is called the unicameral legislature. Meaning, I don't have the second house, that is called the legislative council. You look at any example today, you look at Rajasthan, you look at Gujarat, and you look at all the northeastern states, Mizoram, Nagaland, Arunachal Pradesh, Assam, all the states. Similarly, Orissa, Kerala, all these states, or Tamil Nadu for that matter, or Himachal Pradesh, Punjab, Haryana, so many states are there, Madhya Pradesh. All these states are unicameral, meaning they have only one house, that house is called assembly. And apart from this assembly, if I use the word state legislature of these states, I should also have the governor. Assembly and governor put together is called state legislature in those states. Meaning, governor is a part of the state legislature. But sometimes I'll also come across with the word bicameral legislature. Example, look at this. Jammu and Kashmir, Maharashtra, Karnataka, Uttar Pradesh, Bihar, Andhra Pradesh, Telangana. These are the seven states today. They have the bicameral legislature. The one house is called the assembly and the second house is called the legislative council. Because there are two houses, it is called bicameral legislature. And apart from this bicameral legislature, I also have something called the governors. So governor is common if I am using the word state legislature. Assembly is also common if I am using the word state legislature. But if I specifically use the word bicameral legislature, there is another house in addition to the assembly, and that house is called the legislative council. These things we will see later. But otherwise, I am interested to talk to you regarding the office of the governors. When I use this word governor here, just like the president of India, governor is not a member of the state legislature. He is neither a member in the assembly nor a member in the legislative council. But governor is a part of the state legislature. Since he is a part of the state legislature, governor is also expected to exercise certain functions towards the state legislature. What are they? Let's try to understand this. There is nothing new. Whatever the points we have discussed while talking about the President of India, same functions, same terminology, we are going to use it. But instead of the word Lok Sabha, I'll be using the word assembly. Instead of the word legislative council, instead of using the word Rajya Sabha, I'll be using the word legislative council. Instead of the president, I'll be using the word the governor. That's it. That's the only thing. Now let me show you the document. Governor is a part of the state legislature. State legislature means assembly, legislative council, and the governor. The governor summons the state legislature, meaning assembly and legislative council. Summon means, we know the meaning of all these words, beginning of a session. Governor prorogues the state legislature, meaning he prorogues both assembly and also the legislative council. Prorogue means ending of a session. You know the meaning of this, right? And the governor dissolves the state legislative assembly. Kindly make note of this. President dissolves the Lok Sabha and Rajya Sabha cannot be dissolved because it is a permanent house. In the similar manner, governor dissolves the state legislative assembly. If the legislative council is existing, it is a permanent house. It cannot be dissolved. Am I clear? Next, look at the next point. The governor addresses the state legislature at the beginning of the first session each year. Kindly compare with the President of India in every point. The governor addresses the state legislature at the beginning of the first session each year. Similarly, make a note of this. The meaning of year is calendar year and not a financial year. This is generally the budget session that starts in the month of February. Same thing. The governor also addresses the state legislature at the beginning of the first session after each general election. In this particular case, the general election means the assembly elections, where the people of the state will take part in the voting directly. In the similar manner, look at some point here. Yeah. The governor can send messages to the houses of the state legislature with respect to a bill pending in the legislature or otherwise. That's it. Next one. Sometimes what happens, in case there is a vacancy in the office of the speaker and deputy speaker, during that time, the governor may appoint any member of the assembly to preside over the meeting. In the similar manner, if there is a vacancy in the office of the chairman and deputy chairman, the governor can appoint any member of the legislative council to preside over its meetings. Now, see a very, very simple point. These points I spoke to you even during the discussion regarding the President of India. Just like the Lok Sabha, just like the Rajya Sabha, even in the assemblies also, I have a speaker and I also have a deputy speaker. These two are the constitutional positions. And apart from these two, the speaker of the assembly also appoints something called a panel of speakers. In the similar manner, at the legislative council, I have chairman and deputy chairman. These two are the constitutional positions. Apart from these two, I also have panel of chairman. What is the function of this? In the absence of the speaker, the deputy speaker will be acting as a speaker. In the absence of these two, the panel speaker number one will be acting as the speaker. In his absence, number two, number three, number four persons will be acting as speakers. In the similar manner, even the legislative council also, the same thing will happen. But sometimes there may be a situation, because of any reason, the speaker is not there, deputy speaker is also not there for a long period. Maybe they both might have submitted the resignation letter. Excuse me. Or both might have submitted the resignation letter, or both might have died. Reason may be anything, but these two are not there. During that time, for a long period of time, you cannot run the show with the panel of speakers. That's the reason during that time, the governor will be appointing somebody as the chairman for a period of time. The governor will be appointing somebody as the chairman of the legislative council for a period of time. But during that time, a care will be taken. Only a member of the assembly is appointed as the speaker, that is the interim speaker. Only a member of the legislative council is appointed as the chairman of the legislative council. Time being, that's it. Next one, I'll show you the document here. The governor also nominates one Anglo-Indian to the state assemblies, meaning governor may nominate not more than one Anglo-Indian to the state legislative assemblies. President may nominate not more than two to the Lok Sabha. Governor not more than one to the legislative assembly. It's not a compulsion. That's the reason why in every state we are not very sure that there will be a nominated Anglo-Indian. Apart from this, the governor also nominates not more than 1/6 of the members to the state legislative council from amongst the persons having special knowledge or practical experience in, look at this important, science, arts, literature, social service, and cooperative movement. If you look at the first four, science, arts, literature, and social service, these four fields are common even for the President of India. President will be nominating people from these areas to the upper house, that is the Rajya Sabha. But when it comes to the governor, apart from these four fields, Constitution has permitted one more field, that is called the cooperative movement. Let me say a point regarding the cooperative movement. When I use the word cooperative movement here, the meaning is direct and simple. Sometimes you will come across with the concept of green revolution, a white revolution, yellow revolution. cooperative movement is a movement of the people, and the people will come together, work together for the betterment of the whole society. Because various people have worked together in India, Green Revolution was a success, White Revolution was a success. And the people who involved in this particular movement very seriously and who worked continuously for the success of this particular movement, they may be nominated to the Legislative Council by the Speaker. Legislative Council by the governors. Okay. But the people who are with the cooperative movement background, they are not nominated to the Rajya Sabha by the President of India. This provision is available only at the state level. It can be exercised only by the governors. Am I clear? Next. I'll show you the document. Next one. Look at this. The President of India does not nominate the member to the Rajya Sabha from the field of cooperative movement. Okay. Now, apart from this, the governor also decides the question of disqualification of the members of the state legislature in consultation with the election commission. We have seen this point because of any reason. We have seen the disqualifications of the Lok Sabha members and also the Rajya Sabha members. The same disqualifications are also applicable even to an MLA and even to an MLC. MLA stands for Member of Legislative Assembly. MLC stands for Member of Legislative Council. So these members may be disqualified if they are holding the office of profit, if they are not the citizens of India. Reason may be anything, but they may be disqualified by the governors. During that time, the governor is recommended by the so-called the election commission. Hope you are following. Parliament members may be disqualified by the president, and the state legislature members may also be disqualified by the governor. Next. A bill becomes a law with the assent of the governors. We know this point. A bill is introduced in the Lok Sabha, then it will go to the Rajya Sabha, then the president will sign and it will become an act. In the similar manner, at the state level, the bill is introduced in one house, that is in the assembly. If they have second house, it will go to the second house. After that, it will go to the governor. Later, governor signs it, he gives the assent. Then that particular state bill will become a state legislation. Important. Okay. Now, next point. When a bill is sent to the governor, then the governor can either he will give the assent to the bill. If he gives assent to the bill becomes the law. No problem for me. Or the governor has every right to withhold the assent to the bill. He can just withhold the bill with him. Or just a moment. Or look at this. If the bill is not a money bill, then the governor can return the bill for the reconsideration. You know the meaning of each and every word here. I need not repeat. If the bill is passed by the state legislature, again, with or without amendments, then the governor has to give assent to the bill. Very, 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 very important. Note. Next one, the money bills cannot be sent back to the governor for reconsideration. Okay. Or the governor may reserve the bill for the consideration of the president. What do you mean by this consideration of the president? See, generally what happens, since India is a federation, the state legislature will introduce the bills and pass the bills. And the governor signs these bills. But sometimes what may happen is that the governor may reserve the bill for the consideration of the president. Whenever governor feels that this particular bill has to be considered and should be given only by the president of India, then governor does not sign, he will reserve the bill and he will forward the bill to the President of India. And on that bill, the final decision will be taken only by the President and not by the Governor. Very rarely it happens, but there is a provision that is available in the Constitution. Look at this. This happens in the case if the bill passed by the state legislature endangers the position of the state high court. If it is talking about the powers of the high court, then the governor has every right to reserve the bill for the consideration of the president. Or if the bill is against the provisions of the constitution, or if it is opposing to the directive principles of the state policy, or if it is against the larger interest of the country, or if it is dealing with the compulsory acquisition of the property under Article 31A of the Indian Constitution. During that time, governor cannot take a decision, and the governor will reserve and the governor will forward the bill to the consideration of the president, and the final decision will be taken by the president. Am I clear? Next point is that the governor of a state can promulgate the ordinances only when the state legislature is not in the session. Sir, again we are coming across with the words ordinance. Look at the article, please. It is the article 213. While talking about the President of India, we said article 123. So now we are using another article, that is 213. But the ordinance promulgation, their validity, everything will be same. Look at this. Ordinance is a temporary law. This must be approved by the state legislature within 6 weeks from its reassembly. The governor can also withdraw an ordinance at any time. Now, let me tell you very briefly regarding this. Already, you know what is the meaning of the ordinance. What is the validity of the ordinance? With respect to state legislature, also the same things are there without any modification. But here, ordinance is issued by the governor only during the recess, meaning only when the parliament is not in the session, then only when the state legislature is not in the session, then only the governor will be issuing the ordinances. Once this ordinance is issued, it is valid for a period of time. If the governor issued the ordinance, means the state legislature is not in the session. So from that day, definitely before the completion of 6 months, the state legislature is summoned. And from the date of reassembly, that particular ordinance is valid for not more than 6 weeks. Within the period of 6 weeks from the date of reassembly, it should be passed by the state legislature. Then only that ordinance becomes an act. Ordinance becomes a permanent act. Otherwise, ordinance will be cancelled. Just like the President of India, who can withdraw the ordinance at any point of time, governor is also empowered to withdraw the ordinance at any point of time. Am I clear? Next one. Let's go to the next point here. Look at this. Ordinance making power is the most important legislative function of the governors. Because the function that is to be performed by the state legislature is being performed by the governor only when the legislature is not in the session. Hence, this power is considered to be the most important legislative function of the governors. Next one. The governor lays the reports of State Public Service Commission, State Finance Commission, and the Comptroller and Auditor General before the state legislature. Look at this. If you look at this word, Comptroller and Auditor General, same CAG, what we have discussed while talking about the budget. Meaning, Though India is a federation, we have a single office called CAG. The same CAG is working for both central government and state governments. The only difference is that CAG's basic function is the auditing the accounts. After auditing the accounts of the central government, CAG submits the report to the President of India, and the President of India will place the report before the Parliament. Similarly, after auditing the accounts of the state's government, the CAG submits the audit report to the governor, and the governor places the report before the state legislature. That is the only thing. Hence, depending on the accounts and the audit report, the CAG may be submitting it to the president, or he may be submitting it to the governor if it is related to the state auditing. Next one, we'll go to the next line. What are the financial powers of the governors? Just a moment, hold on here. Yeah, I'm back. Now, if you look at the financial powers of the governor here, same functions again like that of the president. The governor sees that the budget, the word budget I'm using even here, but otherwise the constitution has used the word annual financial statement, and that it is placed before the state legislature. President before the parliament, governor before the state legislature. The money bills can be introduced in the state legislature only on the prior recommendation of the governor. In the similar manner, no demand for a grant can be made except on the recommendation of the governor. Demand for a grant. Clear, I used these words during the discussion of the budget. You know what is the meaning of this. Similarly, the central contingency fund is kept under the control of the president. In the similar manner, the governor can make advances out of the contingency fund of a state to meet any unforeseen expenditure. Okay, next. The governor constitutes a state finance commission every 5 years to review the financial positions of the panchayats and the municipalities. President constitutes Central Finance Commission and the governor constitutes the State Finance Commission. What exactly are the functions of the Central and State Finance Commissions? We'll discuss when we come to that topic. Clear? So these are the financial powers of the governor. So when we go for the analysis, we'll have the more discussion on this. Now look at this. So I'm talking to you regarding the judicial powers of the governors. Look at this, same functions just like that of the President of India. Kindly remember, let me talk to you first of all. While talking about the President of India, we said that the President uses the power of the pardon, commutation, remission, reprieve, respite, so many things. And during that time, I told you the meaning of each and every word. The same meaning is also applicable even here. Just like the President of India, whatever he does, same functions are exercised even by the governor at the state level. But there is a little difference. While talking about the President, we said the President can pardon even the death sentence. If the President pardons a death sentence, the person will be completely absolved. No punishment will be given and he will be like a just free candidate completely. At the same time, the President can also commute the death sentence to the life imprisonment. We have understood. But when it comes to the governor, governor cannot pardon a death sentence. But governor can reduce, governor can commute the death sentence, but governor cannot pardon the death sentence. That is one difference. Sometimes you will also come across with the concept of court martial. So this is a group of the defense forces, defense officials, and these people, with respect to their own personnel, they form into a committee. If a person commits any crime within their group, they will punish the person. Such type of cases may be appealed before the President of India and not before the governor. Meaning, governor cannot look into the cases that are related to the court martial, but the President can look into. Except these two differences, remaining all judicial powers that are exercised by the President are also exercised by the governor. Right? Now let me show you the document again. Look at this. The governor can grant pardons, reprieves, respite, and remission of punishments are suspend, remit, and commute the sentence of any person convicted of any offense against any law relating to a matter to which the executive power of the state extends. Important. Same thing. But the governor cannot pardon a death sentence. In the brackets, please see here, the President has the power of pardon a death sentence. Look at this. The governor cannot grant pardon, reprieve, respite, suspension, remission or commutation in respect to punishment or sentence by a court martial. Just now I told you. But the President enjoys this power. There is a difference. Look at this. Other judicial powers are that at the time of appointment of the judges of the High Court, the President consults the concerned state governor. This we have understood when we are talking about the Supreme Court and High Court judges. But here the point is related to the High Court judges. The governor makes appointments, postings, promotions of the district judges in consultation with the state High Court. Simple. The district court judges are appointed by the governor. Now, look at this. The governor also appoints the persons to the judicial service of the state other than the district court judges in consultation with the state high court and the state public service commissions. Right? So this is about the governor, and I have some important articles with me. Please use this number in the examination. Very fastly, let me go through this. Article 153 says that there shall be a governor for each state. Article 154 says that the executive power of the state shall be vested in the governor and shall be exercised by him either directly or through the subordinates to him in accordance with this constitution. Article 155 says that the governor is appointed by the president. See, we know the meaning of, we know all the points, but I'm just trying to link the point to an article. When it comes to Article 156, it says that the governor holds office during the pleasure of the president. And Article 159 says that the governor shall take an oath to faithfully execute the office and to preserve, protect, and defend the constitution and the law. Next, Article 163 is saying that there shall be a council of ministers with the chief minister as the head to aid and advise the governor in the exercise of his functions, except in so far as he is required to exercise his functions in his discretion. Kindly look at the word discretion. This is the most important word for me. And whatever the points I have seen here, whatever the words you have seen in Article 163, same things are explained in Article number 74, Clause 1. So during that time, we said that there shall be a council of ministers headed by the president, headed by the prime minister, to aid and advise the president of India, and who shall act according to such advice. We have discussed these points. But there we have not spoken even a single word regarding the word discretion, meaning the constitution has not given any discretionary powers to the president. Meaning president is expected to act on the advice that is given by the council of ministers headed by the prime minister. But whereas governor need not. Sometimes there may be a situation where the governor is expected to act on his own discretion, on his own decision. That is the difference between the governor and the president. Governor has discretionary powers, whereas the president does not have any discretionary powers. Okay. And the last one, Article 164, it says that the Council of Ministers shall be collectively responsible to the legislative assembly of the state. Simple point, meaning to the lower house, right? Look at this, some simple points are there. You can go through these points. The constitution mentioned discretionary powers to the governor, not to the president. 42nd amendment made it that the ministerial advice is binding on the president, and no such provision is there for the with respect to the so-called this the governors, right? Now go to the next line. Look at this simple points. You can read on your own. The governor has a situational discretion in the appointment of the chief minister when no party has a clear-cut majority in the assembly, or when the chief minister dies suddenly, or dismissal of the council of ministers when it cannot pull the conference of the assembly. We'll discuss these points when we talk about the chief minister and the council of ministers. Or there may be a situation where the dissolution of the assembly if the council of ministers lost the majority. So all during all the times here, the governor is expected to take the decisions on his own. Some miscellaneous points. The draft constitution provided for the direct election of the governor, but the constituent assembly opted for the appointment method. There is a governor for each state, but after the 7th amendment of 1956, same person can be appointed as a governor for two or more states. If it is so, the salary is shared among the states. And how much? What is the proportion? That proportion will be decided by the president. Residence of a governor is called Raj Bhavan. Look at this. The Chief Justice of the High Court concerned may be appointed as the governor of a state for a temporary period of time. This happens in case of death of the sitting governors. It may happen. The minister holds office during the pleasure of the governor. Advocate General during the pleasure of the governor. State Election Commissioner cannot be removed by the governor. he is removed in the same manner like that of a high court judge. Right? All these points we'll discuss when we come to the respective topics. The chairman, look at this. The chairman and the members of the State Public Service Commission are removed by the president and not by the governor. And the governor holds the office during the pleasure of the president. And the pleasure of the president is not justiciable. And the governor has no security of tenure. Some incidents I have given here in this particular one. In AP, even today also is the same governor, ESL Narasimhan, rejected the advice of the Council of Ministers. Right? So during that time, this is some issue. You can just read it here. It happened in December 2012. The governor rejected the cabinet's recommendation not to sanction permission to the CBI to prosecute Mr. Dharmana Prasad Rao in the Vanpick project case. So four cases have been cited by the lawyers in support of the contention. And the most important one was the Supreme Court's verdict in the case relating to the Abhaya Singh Chautala and Ajay Singh versus CBI. During that time, the Apex Court ruled that the Chautala's case, that the High Court of Punjab and Haryana was right in holding that the appellant has abused an entirely different office than the one they were holding on the date on which cognizance was taken. Hence, it is also applicable to Dharmana Prasad, who was a minister during that time, who was holding the portfolio as the revenue minister then, and now he is holding some other portfolio called roads and buildings. Hence, there is no necessity of the permission from the government and can be prosecuted by the CBI directly. Here, this is an old example, but the intention of speaking to you regarding this example is that, like this, various issues will be coming up in our discussion. During that time, please make a note of that. In whatever the examination you are writing this year, please mention this example that will fetch you the additional marks. Okay, so that is the story with respect to the governor. I'll close the session. So we'll meet in the next class. Till then, I wish you all the very, very best and have a fantastic weekend. Thank you so much.